أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to him, and peace and blessings be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He who is guided by the will of Allah, no one can misguide him, and he who is misguided, no one can guide him except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today our 68th lesson, alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descend his mercy and barakah and acceptance for every single one. Now we are still in the, as you know, in our session, my aim is not to convey a lot of information. Every time I pick and choose just simple piece of information, incidents, okay? We highlight, we try to take as much lessons as we... Tadalu, yes, it's empty. Tadalu, akhwat. Sisters, tadalu, tadalu, fadi, ma fi nas. آه. ما بعرف أنا إذا حدا بدي يجي تفضل It's up to you يعني. تحب تضعي كرسي وتجلس على الأرض لبريحك إن شاء الله إن شاء الله. فاللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. What I was saying. Little information, but we try to highlight and to connect and to try to apply it and to do analogy with our nowadays. Now, in this big, huge context of the Battle of Uhud with a lot of lessons, we have a small incident. And it was narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari. I will highlight just one incident, one narration today. But it has a huge impact on anyone who understands the context of Iman. Let me give you the narration. The narration is, Sahal bin Sa'd al-Sa'idi, one of the great Sahaba, he narrates, and it's narrated by Imam Bukhari. أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم التقى هو المشركون فاقتتلوا فمال رسول الله إلى عسكره ومال الآخرون إلى عسكرهم وفي أصحاب رسول الله رجل لا يدع لهم شاذة ولا فذة إلا اتبعها يضربها بسيفه. Now, what's the meaning? Now, you know, just a pause, one step back. The nature of fighting at that time is not like ours. They fight with their hands, okay? So they keep fighting for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. They got what? Tired. They take rest. Not every, they don't keep fighting 24/7. Like now, you can just... You know, press buttons and, you know, drones will go automatically. No, they don't. So the manpower, so they have like waves of, you know, groups they attack. Another group they go, they eat, they drink, they need the fuel. So with these steps, and one of the incidents happened, Sahal bin Sa'd al-Sa'idi, he's mentioning a man, his name was not mentioned. He said, we noticed that one of the men, he was fighting with us, which means he's supposed to be from the Sahaba. قال لم يدع شاردة ولا شاذة ولا فات إلا وأتبع, which means he was greatly, not just fighting, but the power and the energy and the motivation that he was, you know, moved with, it was amazing. Compared with others, he was, as if, in my own words, he was the most energetic fighter among the fighters. At rest time, after one of the, let's say, rounds of fighting, Sahal says, قال ما أجزأ منا اليوم أحد كما أجزأ فلان. One of the Sahaba said, it seems no one is doing greater than this person. They did not mention his name because it's not mentioned. زاك الله خير. الله يكرمك يا أبو. الله يجزيكم خير. جزاكم الله خيرا لك وللأخت الفاضل ورحم الله والديها. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ما أجزاء. No one is doing something like him. It's like we say, يعني سبحان الله, how great his job is. Immediately, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم replied by saying, أما إنه من أهل النار. He said, for sure he is from the people of the hellfire. Just, he responded by this. Now Sahal says, فقال رجل من القوم أنا صاحبه. One of the Sahaba who heard Prophet Muhammad saying this, he said, أنا صاحب, which means I will watch and keep my eye on him. Because why Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said this? It's something weird. Because someone who's fighting as a great, he's supposed to be aiming the Shahada. And he's in the context of fighting, which means it's either you win or you lose your life. I mean, it's not a place of entertainment. It's not a place of just, I need to have a look to see what could happen. You might lose your life. It's not a joke. It's not an interning session. It's very serious. So this man, when he heard Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم declares that he is from the people of the hellfire, he said, أنا صاحب, which means I will chase him and we'll see what will happen. قال فخرج معه فكلما وقف وقف معه وإذا أسرع أسرع معه, which means whatever he was saying while he was fighting, this the observer now, he was just looking at him. If he went to that area, he went to that area. We'll see what will happen to him. قال فجرح الرجل جرحا شديدا فاستعجل الموت فوضع نصل سيفه بالأرض وذبابه بين ثدييه ثم تحامل على سيفه فقتل نفسه. Said this man, in the fight, he was injured, which is something very common at any battle, and you should be expecting that. And you are there to face this hardship. قال فجرح, he was injured. He could not stand the pain. So he took his own sword. He put the back of the sword on the ground, and he put the edge of the swords in this area, exactly. And he pushed with all of his weight on the sword and killed himself. Which means in the battlefield, he committed suicide. He killed himself. He was not killed by someone else. He killed himself because he was just injured. But simply, that's it. Then that man, the narrator, who observed and witnessed this, came, قال, فخرج الرجل رسوله فقال, أشهد أنك رسول الله. I bear witness that you are Rasulullah. He already witnesses this. But as if we say, لا إله إلا الله. Really you are Rasulullah. How did you know? إن هو إلى وحي. Allah told him simply. قال أشهد أنك رسول الله. I bear witness that you are the prophet, messenger of Allah. قال وماذا؟ قال الرجل الذي ذكرت آنفا أنه من أهل النار. فأعظم الناس ذلك. فقلت أنا لكم به فخرجت في طلبه ثم جرح جوفا فاستعجل ما فوضع. He said. Now, he witnessed that. He came to Prophet Muhammad. He said, I witnessed that you are Rasulullah. قال, why you say? You say, you remember when you said such and such on that man? And the people, their reaction was, you know, he is the greatest fighter. Why Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saying that he is from the people of the hellfire? He said, I decided really to chase him and to see what happened. What happened is such and such and such, and he killed himself. Then look what Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said. عند ذلك قال رسول الله. And here's the scary part of the hadith. قال إن الرجل ليعمل عمل أهل الجنة فيما يبدو للناس. Exactly. إن الرجل ليعمل عمل أهل الجنة فيما يبدو للناس وهو من أهل النار. وإن الرجل ليعمل عمل أهل النار فيما يبدو للناس وهو من أهل الجنة. Now this hadith, we need to understand the context, the meaning of the hadith. The one of us could be doing what superficially seems to the people that he is from the people of the Jannah as an expectation by us, the people who do not know behind the scenes, the realities, the intentions, okay, the motivations. For us, mashallah, niyaluhu, he's doing a great. That's what you think sometimes. Well, in reality, his end result is in the hellfire. We'll explain how now. But Prophet Muhammad is explaining to us that sometimes not everything you see, it is the reality. And it's not a general rule as well. We don't generalize on everyone. Because Prophet was not all the time, Ahlinar, Ahlinar. No. It happened once every, you know, Allahu A'lam, every few years. But it happened. What is the point? Now, when we pause this and we take another hadith, which is very well-known hadith and a sahih hadith. To the best of my memory, let me just tonight see who narrates the other one. Yes, by Imam Muslim. What is, sorry, this one was narrated by Imam Muslim. The other hadith that I want to quote, اللهم صل على سيدنا. Yes, by Imam Muslim, which is about ثلاثة يسعر بهم النار يوم القيامة. Another hadith صحيح, which we know it very well. One of the most three categories that Allah will be fueling the hellfire before the final destination of the people to be thrown in the day of judgment. Three categories from those who are considered in our language pure practicing believers and Muslims. You know, it's very famous. قال ثلاثة من أول من تسعر بهم النار يوم القيامة. قال رجل, one of them is the one who was killed as a shaheed. فيأتي به الله فيعرفه نعمه عليه فيعرفها. Let me give you the narration. I will give it in Arabic just quickly once, then I will give the core of the translation in English. This is a hadith صحيح by Imam Muslim. Abu Huraira is the narrator. قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إن أول الناس يقضى يوم القيامة عليه رجل استشهد فأتي به فعرفه نعمه فعرفها. One of the most categories that Allah will start judging them in the day of judgment will be someone who was killed as a martyr for us. قال فيؤتى به فيعرفه نعمة. Allah will remind him in public about the blessings that Allah has given him. Have I not given you such and such and such? قال فيعرفه, which means he will agree and he will admit that Allah has blessed him with such and such and such. قال فيعرفها. قال فما عملت فيها. Then he will be asked in public, what did you do with the blessings and the power and the capabilities and the abilities that I have given you? فيقول قاتلت فيك حتى استشهد. Immediately he will mention, yeah, Allah, I was fighting in the cause of you, for the sake of you, till I was killed as a martyr. قال كذبت. He will say, you have said what? Lie. عياذ بالله. May God forbid. May Allah protect all of us. He will be told that you are a liar. Wow. The day of judgment. Speaking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال كذبت ولكنك قاتلت لأي قال جريء. You were fighting for the sake of what? People will say about you, you are a brave, gracious person. You know, this reminds us with the influence of the social media now. Da'wah and social media. Some of the du'a, they might fall in this trap. Why you are making da'wah on Instagram or in the YouTube as an influencer? Some of the sisters, they start doing da'wah, for example, on some of the social media. How sometimes you feel, if you are just making da'wah, why the makeup that you are using as a muhajjab and a da'iyah, you don't even use it for your husband at home? I need just to analyze. Are you with me? Are you with me or not? This gives you an idea about the trap that we fall into sometimes. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فيقال له كذبت. You have said lie. You're a liar. قال ثم أمر به فسحب على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار. He will be, you know, شو السحب? He will be pulled, yes. He will be pulled on his face and he will be thrown into the hellfire. ورجل تعلم العلم. يا رب عفوك. وعلمه وقرأ القرآن. Another category represented by a man who spent his life in learning and teaching. Not just in learning and teaching, educating. العلم الشرعي. The Islamic studies and the Quran. قال فأتي به فعرفه نعمه فعرفه. Allah is the same thing. Have I given you such a... Yes, Ya Allah. Enabled you? Yes, Ya Allah. Five languages? Yes. Wealth, health, connections, power, influence? Yes, 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 Ya Allah. ما فعلت فيها؟ قال علم... قال فما عملت فيه؟ What did you do? قال تعلمت العلم وعلمته وقرأته فيك. وقرأت فيك القرآن. فيقال كذبت. I was reading for the sake of you to let the people know you. قالوا له كذبت. You are saying another lie. You are a liar. Even though it's in the context of Quran and knowledge, it's very scary hadith by the way. Which means, قال ولكنك تعلمت ليقال عالم. Your intention here comes. Your motivation inside was, ما شاء الله. No one can debate with this great scholar. He is the best. He's the most powerful, the most influential. Once he heard this, this is what he was seeking in his intention. We don't know. Allah knows. But Allah is telling. قال ورجل, the third one, third category, رجل وسع الله عليه. Which means Allah gave him the wealth, money. وسع الله عليه وأعطاه من أصناف المال كله. Allah, you know, gave him from all types of wealth that you could ever imagine. In our language now, business, trade, money, bitcoins, gold, companies, you know, many things, subhanallah. قال وأعطاه من أصناف المال فأتي به فعرفه. Now the same thing, Allah will mention to him, have I given you such answer? Yes, 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 yes. فما عملت فيه؟ قال ما تركت من سبيل تحب أن ينفق فيها إلا أنفقت فيها لك. قال كذبت ولكنك فعلت ليقال هو جواد. He said, Ya Allah, I spend in every path you like for your sake. قال كذبت. I've said the another lie. You said ليقال جواد, which means he's very generous, ما شاء الله. المحسن الكريم. You know, in the Arabic context, وقد قام المحسن الكريم فلان. It's like some, والعياذ بالله والعياذ بالله, I know some people in our back home culture, when they go to the Hajj, they insist to put on their homes Al-Hajj. And when you address him, if you don't call him Al-Hajj, wallahi, I heard some people, they say, he said, I paid 5,000 for this. You have to call me. This is my title now, Al-Hajj, fulani, fulani. He said, I paid for this title 5,000. Which means, from now on, I am Al-Hajj, fulani. Sheikh. Is it the case that some people think in this way? It's very dangerous. It could wipe, it could demolish all the hasanat that we have. But now this is another hadith sahih. Now this is the general meaning. But here in our context we have real application for this. And the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the time of Uhud, that we were witnessing, you know, we were talking about Mus'ab bin Umayr, Abdullah bin Haram, and Jabir bin Abdullah. We were talking about Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, the Sahabi قال أطعنا بعرجتي عمرو بن الجموح. We are talking about great stories. In this context, someone there was from the people of the Nar. But how? We do not know that. For us, he's a shaheed. But in the context of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how can we explain what happened? Wallahu a'lam. He, you know, killing yourself basically is a big sin. Is it true that everyone kills himself in Islam will be eternally in the hellfire? The answer is no. It's one of the greatest sins. But according to the ulama, if you killing yourself mustahillan, mustahillan, which means you came to a conclusion that you have the full right to do that and Allah has no right upon you. It could be an act of kufr. Not the killing itself, the attitude behind your right of killing yourself. This is called al-istihlal. Like for example, wal-iyadu billah, if I'm drinking alcohol, okay, knowing it's haram, admitting I'm committing a sin, yet I'm drinking, what is my classification in Islam? A sinful person. It is a sin, it's haram. Once I repent, inshallah, may Allah accept. Everything could be deleted. Even if I continue doing for a long time, as long as I'm admitting that I know it's Allah's right, and it's haram, and I know I'm committing, and all the time I'm afraid from the punishment of Allah. It's a big sin, but I'm still a believer, be careful. But what if I don't drink, but I have the attitude that alcohol is not haram? What is my classification?
this? Non-believer. But I'm not drinking. Yes, the attitude now.
This is istihlal. Istihlal means I feel internally that I have the right to be an opponent to Allah in his decision. Wow. But I did not drink. Our biggest concern, not the action. The attitude behind the action. Depending on that, the attitude, it's mixed with the intention now. Okay? Now, that man, when he did it, Wallahu A'lam, it seems when he did it, he had that attitude. It's a great sin. Maybe, Wallahu A'lam, you don't know the ghaib, but probably he's from the people of the hellfire. But he was fighting. No, he was not doing that for the sake of Allah, Wallahu A'lam. Or simply, even he did it, once the pain came to him, he decided to finish his existence. But it's not your right. I don't care. Allah prohibit this. This is part of your test. I don't care. But let's come to our time. What is the lesson? The lesson, the biggest lesson in this context is not the action. Not the action will make you being saved from the punishment of Allah. It is what? The intention. The attitude. It's very important, by the way. That's why we can read in the context of understanding the Islamic history and Islamic legislations, some people with their intention and attitudes, they reached higher levels, much more than people. They did actions, but they did not have any kind of ajr. Type. What is another evidence? ذكروني تبعت عمارة المسجد الحرام المشركين أجعلتم الله يجزيك الخير يس جزاك الله خير أجعلتم سقاية الحج وعمارة المسجد الحرام إيش كما آمن بالله واليوم الآخر. Now Allah سبحانه وتعالى is replying to those non-believers. For them, I mean the pagans of Mecca. For them, they were proud that they used to do what we call in our Arabic Islamic history as-siqaya wal-rifada, which is what? Providing, drink and food for the pilgrims, which is a great job now. You are talking about financing thousands of people who are coming to do religious, pilgrimage around, which takes weeks and months among the year. And at that time, it was not easy to bring the water and the food for thousands for free. Now, nowadays, with all the facilities that we have, if we have a big event of thousands of people, many people, they can't afford. With all kind of easiness and facilities that we have, transportation, the water is easy, the food, yet you need tens of thousands to provide just for a short time. What if for weeks and months on yearly basis, no transportation, no sources of water easily, no sources of food? We don't have, they did not have, fridges, they did not have a storage, they did not have everything should be done, on the spot. The effort is 100 times on that time. So providing this is a great effort. Okay, it used to be done for the sake of what? Pride, reputation, power and authority. But where is Allah in this equation? Out. That's why we say we do this. I say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَجِّ وَعِمَارَةً وَكَمَنْ آمَلَ. Hey, if you don't believe and submit and respect the source of commandments, everything you are doing is nothing. Everything is doing what? وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. So that some people, the people who do not understand this context, and let me finish this. And this is just the message of today, and I will finish. This reminds me with the very story that we repeated many times here in this session, which is Mr. Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl was a close friend for many mushrikeen who later became Sahaba. So when they became Sahaba, they started telling about what used to happen between them and him when he was in the back scene fighting Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the very beginning, from day one, for 13 years plus the 2 years. You know, they are friends, and they did a lot of plans to get rid of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they were back. So in some occasions they were asking him Ya Abu al-Hakam, because his original title was Abu al-Hakam, Amr ibn Hisham. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam called him Abu Jahl. So one of them asked him, Ya Abu al-Hakam, أولا تعلم أن محمد النبي. Don't you know, يعني between you and me. It's like two, for example, officers of Arabic مخابرات. While they are torturing an innocent accused person of committing something he has not done it, and they know. Because they are who did it. So for sure they know. Because they fabricated it. So they are torturing someone of doing something. This thing has not been done. And they are the source of fabricating that this thing has been done. يعني imagine that. This is how Abu Jahl was with the cover. قال, يا أبا الحكم, أولا تعلم أن محمد النبي? He said, بلا أعلم. Yes, I know. But طب يعني between you and me, why you don't follow him? His famous reply was, عمر بن هشام, he was from Bani Makhzum. From Quraysh. You know, Quraysh is a big tribe. They have clans. Okay? Quraysh has Banu Makhzum and Banu Hashim. He said, قال أطعموا, the context now, فأطعمنا. He was talking about the competition between the clan of Bani Makhzum and the clan of Bani Hashim under the big umbrella of Quraysh, with the prestige and reputation and, you know, and such and such up on the level of the Arabic peninsula. Said, قال أطعموا, Banu Hashim, they used to feed the pilgrimage, which is, you know, it's like now the propaganda that big powers they do when they give humanitarian aids. They do it for what? I'm asking, do it for humanitarian reasons? If that's the case, we should not be witnessing what's happening now. So they don't care about human being. They have another agenda. Reputation, power, you know, prestige, or whatever. But definitely not for the sake of Allah. The same thing. Has anyone mentioned we are seeking the ajr? Seriously, I'm asking. No. طيب. قال اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. قال أطعموا, they fed the pilgrims وأطعمنا. So we were able to match them. قال سقوا فسقينا. They provided the water. We did as well. So we were able to match them. So we are competing. قال حتى إذا كنا كفرسي رهان. Till we were as if like a two race horses. One of us about to win. You know, just competing. You know? The horses in the race. Just they, we. قال جاء منهم نبي فأنا لنا بذلك. A prophet came from them. How can we afford this? How, we can't create a prophet. We can compete in food and water, but we can't compete in bringing a prophet. قال لا والله لا أتبعه. By Allah, I will not follow him. يعني, excuse me, Mr. Abu Jahl, you are aware that he's a prophet. طبعا, yes, I am aware. Why do you want the arrogance? This is the disease of Mr. Iblis. But my point is, who cares about the action? What's the attitude? The intention. This is the biggest lesson of our lesson today from the huge context of the Battle of Uhud, and it was narrated by Imam Bukhari. Superficially, he's a great Sahabi, the most energetic fighter in the context of Uhud, and they did not tell us about his name. Who cares? Subhanallah. Yet, he was from the people of the hellfire. You know, this gives us what? In my final statement, this contains the glad tidings and a very, very scary message. Glad tidings for honest, genuine people. That whatever obstacle in your face prevented you from achieving what you want to do by your niyyah, you will take the ajr. طب what is the scary side of the coin? Be careful. Whatever you do, if there is no pure intention for the sake of Allah, I, you, we are wasting our time. So let's redirect our intentions. That's why Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, the greatest, one of the greatest ulama in our context, when he collected his sahih from the highest rank of authentic, genuine hadith, out of these thousands of hadith, he decided to start his book with hadith number one. What was it? إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. Indeed, actions are considered by intention. فمن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها ومن كانت هجرته لله ورسوله وقال وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. And everyone will be, you know, considered according to his niyyah. We have a good niyyah and we have a bad niyyah, because we have both intentions, but it's hidden. Allah knows them. قال فمن كانت هجرته لله ورسوله فهجرته لله ورسوله. His immigration, his action, his sadaqah, his whatever for the sake of Allah, it will be the sake of Allah, because Allah knows. قال ومن هجرته للدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة يتزوج of his intention or for something else like getting married for doing the hijra, it came in the special context, but it's something else now. قال فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. Why you are speaking? We are doing such and such. يعني we can have, for example, two brothers. Both of them, they spend 6 hours in the gym every day to make a bodybuilding with the very nice muscles, triceps or biceps or six packs or something. Okay, assalamu alaikum, brother. What is your intention? He said, I want to defend weak people for the sake of Allah. The second one, what do you think? I want to defend people. If real inside one of them, his real aim was to seek the attraction of nice girls in the streets with his six packs, could it happen? Is this possible? Come on. Regardless of what I'm claiming, what is my intention? Allah knows. I want to defend, I want. That's why the glad tidings, sometimes, subhanallah, sometimes the one of us might achieve the highest level of martyrship even though he was not enabled to witness not even simple battle in his life. Is this possible? Yes. Well, this is a hadith. من سأل الله تعالى الشهادة بصدق أناله الله إياها ولو على فراش الموت. Wow. But this is a two-edged sword. It's not just, it's a glad tidings, but it's a very horrible if I do not purify my intention for the sake of Allah. Jazakum Allah khair. This is the lesson of today. We will continue. طبعا, tomorrow we have the tafsir, and next Monday we have the seerah. Assalamu alaikum.